Hi, I'm Mark Doty. I'm a professor in the English department and the director of Writers House, and I am delighted to welcome you to this, the second event in our Writers at Rutgers series this year. I am delighted to welcome Elizabeth Kolbert, a remarkable writer on environmental issues, probably the foremost prose writer working on climate change in our country now. And Pulitzer Prize winner. She will be introduced more fully in a few minutes, but first, some announcements while you are silencing your cell phones, if you will be so kind. I have a host of co-sponsors to thank for their support of this evening's reading. First of all, Writers House in the English Department. Then let's make sure I can make all my own handwriting. The School of Environmental and Biological Science, Rutgers Climate Institute, the Cook Campus Dean, University Undergraduate Academic Affairs, the Institute of Earth and Environmental Sciences. Did I get that one wrong? I think I did. Earth, Ocean, and Atmospheric Sciences, and finally RU250, the Anniversary Initiative. Thanks to all of them for making this take place. Please, in a moment, I will welcome the introductor. After Elizabeth Kolbert is introduced, she will speak for about 50 minutes. Afterwards, there will be a brief Q&A period, and you'll be invited to come up to microphones in either aisle to ask your questions. When that has finished, we will move next door for dessert reception, and Ms. Kolbert will be available for signing books. I want to welcome now Robert Goodman, who is the Dean of Environmental and Biological Sciences, the School for Environmental and Biological Sciences. It is wonderful to have a scientist coming to this podium to speak at what is usually a literary occasion, demonstrating that this can certainly be both. He is a microbiologist. He has been at Rutgers for 12 years, and he brings a clear and evident passion to this evening's program. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark, and good evening, everyone. I, too, am delighted to welcome you to this lecture sponsored by our school and by Writers House. This isn't the first time, and it won't be the last, when our school and Writers House collaborate to bring leading science writers to Rutgers. So we are close to the end of the year-long celebration of RU250. The 250th anniversary of the founding of Queen's College in November of 1766. One of our school's contributions to the RU250 has been our sponsorship of a year-long series of lectures and other events that we call the Exploring the Anthropocene, the Age of Us. We began the year with a lecture by Andy Revkin, now at Pace University, a climate blogger extraordinaire, and previously a columnist for the New York Times, known to many of you. Tonight, we mark the closing of this series, this long and provocative series, with the lecture you're about to hear. The proximal rationale for inviting Elizabeth as our speaker tonight is her powerful, deeply researched, and brilliantly written book, winner of the 2015 Pulitzer Prize in General Nonfiction, The Sixth Extinction, an Unnatural History. But why extinctions? And what is the connection between extinctions and Anthropocene? Geologists in the 19th century developed an account of the history of the Earth based on what they found in the rocks. From the record in the rocks over the past 4 billion years are found various physical, chemical, and more recently biological changes that are used to deduce major punctuation marks in this history. Since about 500 million years ago, before present, the evidence from in the rocks, fossils of extinct organisms, have also been used to demarcate these transitions. This system is called chronostratigraphy, and it divides geological time into eons and periods, which are subdivided into eras and then further into epochs. So we now live in the Holocene epoch, which began roughly 12,000 years ago at the end of the last ice age. The Holocene is the latest epoch in the Quaternary period of the Cenozoic era. The Holocene epoch includes the entire period of the global expansion of modern humans and the emergence of human civilization. It's one of the briefer periods, sorry, one of the briefer epochs in the history of life on Earth, of all of Earth, sorry. As Kolbert relates in her compelling story of the ongoing sixth extinction, serious consideration is now being given by the International Commission on Stratigraphy, the ICS, to designate formally a new epoch, the Anthropocene. In fact, the Anthropocene Working Group, last month at its meeting of the ICS in Cape Town, formally recommended the designation of the Anthropocene epoch, which they argued began in 1950. This is notable, as it's the first time that we have a proposal to mark a new epoch in the present rather than in the past tense. That is, all previous epochs, eras, periods, and eons began before the existence of human civilization. Elizabeth Kolbert has been, since 1999, a staff writer at The New Yorker. She previously was on the staff of The New York Times. She first wrote for The Times in the 1980s from Germany, where she studied as a Fulbright scholar at the University of Hamburg. She graduated from Yale with a degree in literature. In all manner of film and book reviews, comments, annals, the talk of the town articles, the scope of the topics that she has written for The New Yorker demonstrate her enormous bandwidth, both in interest and in accomplishment. From climate change and the protection of land and ocean resources, to bedbug genomes, to the threat in Miami of climate change, of sea level rise, to Alexander von Humboldt, to profiles of US political leaders, to Tiger Mom. Both The Sixth Extinction and a previous book, Field Notes from a Catastrophe, started as articles in The New Yorker. Her latest contribution, Letter from Greenland, entitled A Song of Ice, online it's called Greenland is Melting, is in this week's New Yorker. I'd like to quote you briefly. I first visited the Greenland ice sheet in the summer of 2001. At that time, vivid illustrations of climate change were hard to come by. Now they're everywhere. In the flooded streets of Florida and South Carolina, and the beetle-infested forests of Colorado and Montana, in the too warm waters of the Mid-Atlantic and the Great Lakes and the Gulf of Mexico, in the mounds of dead mussels that washed up this summer on the coast of Long Island, and the piles of dead fish that coated the banks of the Yosemite River, the Yellowstone River. But the problem with global warming, she continues, and the reason it continues to resist illustration even as the streets flood and the forests die and the mussels rot on the shores, is that the experience is an inadequate guide to what is going on. The climate operates on a time delay. When carbon dioxide is added to the atmosphere, it takes decades, in a technical sense, millennia, for the Earth to equilibrate. In effect, we are living in the climate of the past, but already we've determined the climate's future. That passage is a sample of what a brilliant writer Elizabeth Kolbert is. She's been recognized with many national and international awards, notably, of course, the Pulitzer. But I draw your attention in particular to awards, among many others, from major scientific organizations, including the American Association for the Advancement of Science, the National Academies of Sciences, and the American Geophysical Union. In addition to her writing and speaking career, she is the class of 1946 Environmental Fellow in Residence at Williams College, and she lives with her family in Williamstown, Massachusetts. Elizabeth, we're delighted to have you here this evening at Rutgers. Colleagues of Rutgers, please join me in a warm welcome for Elizabeth Kolbert.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for coming out tonight. The difficulty with such a wonderful introduction, like the one that Bob just gave, is the difficulty of living up to it, to be honest. And so I will start by saying that, by trying to lower expectations, I guess. And I also, I want to say it's really an honor to be here, and I am not going to also thank the list of many, many sponsors here, but I want to thank everyone and to say that it's really an honor to come out in the midst of the writer series of so many great writers, and also, I guess, at the end of another series of really, really eminent people who are trying to raise awareness about climate change. And what I'm going to talk to you tonight is actually climate change will be part of it, the Anthropocene, and under the very broadest category of all, in my view at least, of what's been called the Sixth Extinction. So I wrote a book on that topic that came out a couple years ago already now, and this fellow up here on the screen is one of my favorite characters from the book. So those of you, you know, who read it and got all the way to the end will recognize him. It's not a test. But his name is Kanoe, and he's a Hawaiian crow or alala. And he looks a lot like, you know, an ordinary crow that we'd have around here in the northeastern U.S. or all across the continental U.S. But I've been told by the ornithologically gifted that you can tell that there are certain telling differences, that his beak is fatter, for example, and so are his legs. So before humans arrived on the Hawaiian Islands, the archipelago actually had several species of crows, which probably diverged from our crows here in the lower 48 at least several hundred thousand years ago. So this is a story that's a lot like the story of Darwin's finches, which you're probably familiar with, of an animal arriving on an archipelago, we're not entirely sure how, and then speciating out to fill different niches and to survive in different sorts of habitats. So the difference is that in the case of Hawaiian crows, most of the species did not survive until recent times. This is the only species that did, and it's actually native to the Big Island. And it too is now extinct in the wild. The last wild alalas were seen in 2002. And there are probably a number of factors that led to its loss. Habitat loss, cutting down forests on the Big Island, introduced species like mongoose that feed on the young of birds and on their eggs, and also introduced mosquitoes that carry avian malaria, which have been really devastating for Hawaii's bird life. So a few decades before the last wild alalas died out, people realized that the species was crashing and was in very big trouble. So they took the last remaining birds that they could find out of the forest, or what was left of the forest, and they brought them to a breeding facility on a whole other island, on the island of Maui. And that is where Kanoe himself was born. And he is, as they say, quite an odd duck. He was raised by people, and it seems that he doesn't really self-identify as a bird, or at least not as a crow. So one of the women who takes care of him told me that he once fell in love with a spoonbill. So Kanoe was at this breeding facility on Maui, and there are now maybe 150 birds that they've bred up there. So roughly 75 of them were female and eligible mates for him, but he refused to mate with any of the other crows. So these are all the alalas that are left, and Kanoe is pretty old now, and for precisely that reason, he's actually over 20 years old, which is pretty old for a crow. And for precisely that reason, his genes are considered very important. So since he refused to mate with any of these birds, a couple years ago, he was flown to California and brought to live at the veterinary hospital of the San Diego Zoo. And there he came under the care of a reproductive physiologist by the name of Barbara Durant. And every spring when it's mating season back on the Big Island, Durant takes Kanoe on her lap and strokes him in a way that he is supposed to find very, very exciting. And she is hoping that Kanoe will, you know, as it were, divest himself of some of his genetic material, and then she will take it back with her in a little vial back to Maui and try to artificially inseminate some of the female crows there. And a couple years ago, I was out in San Diego, and Barbara Duran offered to introduce me to Kanoe, and he turns out to be a very charismatic, if sexually confused, bird. So he has this palatial cage, and we could sort of stand around, and his cage is as big as, you know, your living room, probably. And he has a lot of toys. You can see that's one of his toys, but he has much more sophisticated toys, too. And so we go into his cage, and he hopped over, you know, to converse with us. And it seemed to me that he definitely recognized Durant. He seemed a little bit embarrassed to see her. That may be projection, of course. But he seemed a little bit embarrassed by their rather intimate relationship. And so Durant knows exactly what Kanoe likes, and she had stopped at this sort of avian commissary they have at the zoo, and she picks up these little newborn mice that are they're tiny little mice with no hair. They're known in the trade as pinkies, and he really likes these pinkies, so she brought him a cupful of these little mice, and he hopped over to peck at them. And crows are very smart, as I'm sure you all know, and they can imitate human speech. And Kanoe says, "I know." It sounds a little bit demented when he says it, but if you are queued up and you know what you're listening for, you can hear it. And so to me, Kanoe sort of sums up this very strange and very sad situation that we find ourselves in. So here we have this crow who is one of the very, very last representatives of his species, and people are going to quite fantastic lengths to save this species. They've set up this breeding facility, they're flying crows around the country, they are in effect giving hand jobs to crows. So people really do care about animals, about what Rachel Carson called the problem of sharing our earth with other creatures. The fact that I'm standing here, the fact that you are all here tonight, I think are testaments to that commitment. I think for many people, it's an important moral commitment. E.O. Wilson has given a name to what he calls the human urge to affiliate with other forms of life, and he calls it biophilia. But at the same time, we are, as a species, as you all know, we are killers. We're driving more and more species to the brink, like the ala, and we're driving more and more species over the brink. So Kanoe, in his sort of Hamlet-like getup, his black outfit there, and with this sort of oracular cawing that he does, I know, he made a big impression on me, and he is, in my mind, as I said, sort of a symbol for this great mess that we have gotten ourselves into. So what is the sixth extinction? Obviously, the implication here is that there have been five earlier extinction events, and indeed, that is exactly the case. So what you're looking at here is a very famous graph in paleontological circles. It's a representation of the marine fossil record. And it's a little bit complicated, but not terribly. What you're looking at on the x-axis, the horizontal axis there, is time going backwards to your left, 600 million years. Those are the geological periods on the bottom there. And then on the vertical axis, we're just looking at the number of marine families in the fossil record. And those dips, those points where you see the numerals, those are just points when the number of marine families in the record suddenly dropped. And so those of you who are bio students, those of you who remember your bio, will remember that a family is a group that's just above a genus, and a genus is a group that's just above a species. So if one species made it through those extinction events that are numbered there, that family counted as a survivor. So on the species level, each one of those events represents losses that are much, much greater than at the family level. So every one of those numbers, those dips, represents a loss of roughly 3/4 of the species on Earth, in some cases even more. So these are just the 5 major mass extinctions of the last 600 million years, and they are sometimes called the Big 5. And they are just moments, geologically speaking, of very short amounts of time when the diversity of life on planet Earth for some reason plummeted. And one pretty good description, which comes from 2 British paleontologists, is that mass extinctions are events that eliminate, quote, a significant proportion of the world's biota in a geologically insignificant amount of time. So the first of those events, number one there, that took place at the end of what's known as the Ordovician period, that was a long, long time ago, over 400 million years ago. And most of life, in fact, almost all of life was confined to the oceans at that point. Life on land really just hadn't evolved yet. So it was a very devastating event for marine life and not very devastating for terrestrial life simply because there was no terrestrial life. And it's believed that event was caused by a massive glaciation. And number 5 there, where you see that number 5, that is the most famous of all mass extinctions, the event that took out the dinosaurs about 66 million years ago. And there's a pretty broad scientific consensus now that event was caused by an asteroid impact. And in fact, there are spots in New Jersey where you can find this very famous iridium layer that identifies that event. And I don't have a picture of that, unfortunately, but this is a drawing that I like a lot. Okay. So to say that we are in the sixth mass extinction is obviously a pretty serious claim to make. And the reason that we're in the sixth, and some scientists would say we're just on the verge of it, we can still prevent it, and some scientists would say we're pretty deep into it already, is that we are changing the world very radically and very, very fast, so not unlike an asteroid impact. And in fact, you will hear, and I have heard scientists say, this time around, we humans are the asteroid. So how are we doing this? How are we changing the world on an asteroid-like scale? Well, unfortunately, there are a lot of ways, and this is the reason that people are contemplating renaming the geological epoch that we are now in. But this evening, I'm only going to talk about 3 of them because we have a limited amount of time. How we're changing the atmosphere, how we're changing the oceans, and how we're changing what Charles Darwin called the principles of geographical distribution. So let's start with the atmosphere. Every year, we humans add about 10 billion metric tons of carbon to the atmosphere. That is just counting the weight of the carbon. If you want to count the weight of the carbon dioxide, you've got to multiply that by 3.6, so 36 billion tons. That's coming for the most part from burning fossil fuels. You all know this, so I'm not going to belabor it tonight. We drive our cars. We turn on our lights. There are now 7.4 billion people on the planet, heading very rapidly to 7.5, and it adds up pretty quickly. And what we are doing when we burn fossil fuels is we are just taking carbon that was buried under the Earth over the course of hundreds of millions of years, and we are transferring it back into the atmosphere. So we are basically running geological history backwards, and we're doing it at a very high speed. We're taking a process that took hundreds of millions of years to run in one direction, and we're running it in the opposite direction in a matter of centuries. And if you were an alien and you came to visit planet Earth and you had no idea, you know, really what these people were up to, or even that they were people, you could easily conclude that the primary purpose of modern industrialized society is to effect this transfer as quickly as possible, to see how much carbon we can get out of the ground and put up into the air and how fast we can do it. And of course, we are actively measuring this process. We're actively looking at how well how fast we're adding carbon to the atmosphere at the observatory on the top of Mauna Loa, also in Hawaii. So this is a very, very famous graph. I'm sure most people in the room and in the overflow room in there are familiar with it. It's called the Keeling curve. It's named after a scientist named Charles David Keeling, who spent most of his career at the Scripps Institution in California, and who was just the first person to sort of figure out how to measure carbon dioxide levels in the air very accurately. What you're looking at here is just a record, a continuous record of CO2 levels taken since 1958. And once again, on the horizontal axis, we've got time going back to 1958, and on the vertical axis, we've got the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere in parts per million. And that's a very recent reading, just from last week. We're at 401 parts per million. And that green line shows us when we crossed the 400 mark. Now, there's a seasonal component to CO2 levels when the trees and the plants of the northern hemisphere put out their leaves, start taking up CO2 for photosynthesis. Globally, CO2 levels go down. And in the northern hemisphere winter, when the trees go dormant and the plants go dormant and stop photosynthesizing, globally, CO2 levels start to go up. And that is just a function of the fact that we have more plants and more land in the northern hemisphere. So as I said, that's a reading from about last week, about 401 parts per million. We're now in the upward part of this cycle. And that upward, up and down rhythm is going to continue indefinitely, forever. But we have probably gotten to the point where we're never going below 400 parts per million again, at least not in the lifetimes of anyone here in this room tonight. And that figure is going to keep rising until we stop emitting CO2, which at this point, at least, we show no signs of doing. And if we want to know how well we're doing on a longer time scale at this, you know, putting CO2 back into the atmosphere project, we can look back at ice cores. So this is actually an ice coring operation that I visited just a couple months ago on top of the Greenland ice sheet. We are standing here on about 8,000 feet of ice. And when you take an ice core, what you do is you take a drill that looks like a tube, basically, with some pretty sharp teeth at the end, and you stick it down into the ice, and you set it spinning. And if you're lucky, it's logistically not that easy, you pull up a cylinder of ice that's about a yard and a half long and a couple inches in diameter. And the ice sheet itself, the Greenland ice sheet, the Antarctic ice sheet, all these ice sheets are snow that has accumulated year after year after year, has not melted. Every year the snow fell and did not melt. And so when you extract a core, you're going backwards in time, year by year. And when you pull it up, you can get a lot of interesting information out of it. Scientists have figured out how to get temperature, a temperature record out of it, by looking at the isotopic composition of the water. And you can also get actually actual samples of the atmosphere get sealed into the ice, little bubbles of air. So you can actually get this amazing record of the atmosphere going back in time. So what we're looking at here, another really famous graph, is the longest ice core we have so far. This comes from Antarctica. And once again, we've got time on the bottom going back 800,000 years. And then once again, on the vertical axis, we have CO2 levels. So you see that up and down cycle. Those are ice ages. During the last ice age, which ended about 12,000 years ago, huge ice sheets covered most of the northern US all the way down to Manhattan. And those high points, so when CO2 levels are around 300 parts per million, those are interglacial periods when the ice retreats. And we are, of course, in an interglacial period right now. That's what defines the Holocene, the period since this interglacial began. But as you can see from that chart, we've really radically changed the shape of this curve, right? You can also see when modern humans emerged. It was not very long ago, only about 200,000 years ago. So CO2 levels have not been above 300 parts per million for at least the last 800,000 years. And now they're up over 400 parts per million at that blue star. And if we want to see where we're headed, we have to sort of push that graph down because the scale gets too out of whack. So we're looking at the same thing here now, that same core with, I took this from a government, a US federal government website, and they stopped updating it after 2008. I'm not sure if it got too frightening or not. But anyway, that's why it says 2008 there, where that blue dot is. Where that green dot is, up around 550 parts per million, that's where we're headed by the end of the century if we work hard to keep our emissions down. And that yellow dot, which is up around 900 parts per million, is where we're headed if we don't work to keep our emissions down. So by the end of this century, CO2 levels will almost certainly be twice as high as they were before we embarked on this great world-changing project at the start of the Industrial Revolution, and quite possibly they'll be three times as high. And if we want to go even further back than 800,000 years, we start to run out of ice, but there are ways of teasing out the composition of the atmosphere from other things, like the shells of tiny little marine creatures that were deposited on the ocean floor. And these methods are not as exact, but they give us a pretty good picture. And it turns out that if we want to find CO2 levels that are much higher than today's, we have to go back quite a long way, perhaps as far back as the Miocene, around 20 million years ago. And if we just keep pouring CO2 into the atmosphere the way we are right now, we could very easily reach Miocene levels within the next few decades. And if we keep on going along that high emissions line, we could reach Eocene levels. So now we're talking about going back to levels that haven't been seen in 50 million years by the end of this century. So what's significant about this, as you all know, is that CO2 has certain geophysical properties that make it a greenhouse gas. And I am not, many of you have been to many global warming talks now, I'm not going to give you the whole global warming spiel again. I just want to say, though, in the midst of this wonderful presidential campaign, that this is very basic science. And this fact that CO2 traps heat near the surface of the Earth has been understood now for more than 150 years. This wonderful contraption is a spectrophotometer. It was constructed in the 1850s by a British scientist named John Tyndall. And John Tyndall was interested in the properties of different gases, and when he ran carbon dioxide through his machine, he recognized right away that it was important heat-trapping gas and that was important for the climate of the Earth, and that if we had no what we would now call greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, the Earth would in fact be frozen. So this is not a new, this is not something that was cooked up recently by the Chinese or by anyone. It's something that we have understood, that scientists have understood for a very long time now. And if you're raising CO2 levels rapidly, as we saw that we are, you would expect that all other things being equal, you'd expect that averaged global temperatures would be going up quite rapidly. And as you all know, that is indeed the case. So this next slide that I'm going to show you, it's not a slide, it's a little animation. It was made by a British climate scientist. It's very beautiful, and it's just showing you what's happened to average global temperatures over the last 150 years or so. So since we started having reliable instrumental temperature records. So the baseline is just the average for the period. I think it's a pretty cool animation. I think it's pretty easy to understand. It just takes a couple of seconds to get going, so just give it a couple seconds. So you see that that line ends right up near 1.5 degrees Celsius above the pre-industrial average. It's going to start again, in case you're interested. And for people who followed the recent negotiations, I guess it's about a year ago, in Paris, the Paris Climate Agreement, that agreement said we should really keep global temperatures from going above 2 degrees Celsius. That's the outer line there. And we should try to keep them from going above 1.5 degrees Celsius, above pre-industrial levels. But as that animation shows you, we are really right up against 1.5 already. Now, this is a different way of looking at similar information. This is from NOAA. This is just a representation of the warmest years on record. That red one was last year, 2015. That was a very warm year. As I'm sure you know, it was an El Nino year, which tends to mean warm years. So 2015 was a record breaker. But now 2016, the year we're in, is turning out to be a really astonishing record breaker, way, way above 2015. So warm that over the summer, in July, NASA came out and said, just based on the first 6 months of data, we can tell you it's going to be the warmest year on record. And that was recently updated in September for the first 9 months of data. And there's basically a 99% chance that 2016 will beat the record once again. So what does all this mean for living creatures, the creatures with whom we share the planet, as Rachel Carson said? Well, I'm going to show you one last graph here, or representation, I should say. This shows you that the temperature increases that we've seen are not evenly distributed around the globe. So where you're seeing those really warm colors up in the Arctic, that's where it has warmed the most, okay? And this is a very predictable effect. It was predicted a long time ago by the very earliest climate models. And it's one of the reasons that the polar bear has become really an icon of global warming. I recently went to a talk by an acquaintance of mine who does law and climate change issues, and she made sort of only a half joke and said that all climate change talks, it's like a law, they have to contain a picture of a polar bear. So here's my picture of a polar bear. But obviously the polar bears hunt off of the Arctic sea ice. The sea ice is disappearing very, very fast, and if you depend on the sea ice and it's disappearing, then you would kind of imagine that you're going to be in trouble. And in fact, you know, we don't know whether polar bears will actually be able to adapt to a loss of sea ice or not. We're unfortunately going to find that out, though. But one of the points that I want to make to you tonight, and it is not my point, I really want to emphasize this, it's the point that was made to me by the scientists out in the field who are studying this, is that the effects of climate change are likely to be even more dramatic in the tropics. And there are a couple reasons for this, the most important of which is that the tropics are where most things actually live. So here we are in the Andes. And this picture was taken from an altitude. We're in Peru, the Peruvian Andes. And you're looking down from an altitude of around 12,000 feet. Along that ridge there. And I went to this spot a couple of years ago with an American biologist named Miles Silman, who teaches at Wake Forest. And what Miles and his students had done is they had mapped out these plots going down this ridge. So at regular intervals of elevation, they had mapped out these plots of 2.5 acres each. And then inside each plot, they had tagged and ID'd every single tree with a diameter of over 4 inches. So they had 20 plots, as I say, starting at 12,000 feet and then going down in elevation. Each of them was 2.5 acres, so we get to 50 acres. And in these 50 acres, they had found 1,000 different species of trees. Now, I come from Massachusetts. In Massachusetts, we have 55 native species of tree. And if you go further north, if you go to Canada, to the boreal forest, which is one of the largest intact forests that still exists on Earth, covers more than 1 billion acres, you will only find 20 species of trees. So that gives you a sense of the disparity, how much diversity there is in the tropics versus how much there is up here in the temperate zones. So the point of this experiment in the Andes was to see what happens as the climate warms. So one of the corollaries to having very high number of species in the tropics is that species tend to have a very narrow climatic range. So as we were hiking down that ridge, starting at around 12,000 feet, and it took us 3 days to get down to sea level, and I want to say that fortunately we were hiking down. Miles Silman said to me, as we were, you know, walking along this path, just pick out a leaf that has an interesting shape and try to follow it down this path. It was actually a lot easier to say than to do, to be honest, because there were an awful lot of leaves along this path. But anyway, the point was, if you pick out a leaf with an interesting shape, you're only going to see it for maybe 100, maybe a couple hundred yards or so, because that's the tree's entire range. It only lives in this very narrow band where the conditions are now favorable for it. So by laying out these 20 plots, what Miles and his students were trying to do is to find out how these very narrowly adapted species were going to react to climate change. So to track the climate, to track the temperature, to stay in the same what's called isotherm, they were going to have to be moving upslope by several yards every year, because that's how fast the Andes are warming. And of course, it's very difficult for a tree to get up and move. But it can do sort of the next best thing, which is that, you know, it puts out its seeds, and these get blown around or distributed by animals. And if the conditions are favorable for it, it will grow in a new place. And so they go back year after year. They recensus all the trees. And what they found after about a decade is that some of these species were indeed moving fast enough to track the climate. So maybe a tree that you used to find at 2,000 meters, you know, maybe you now find it at 2,050 meters or at 2,100 meters. But most of the trees, the vast majority of them, were not moving fast enough to track the climate, and most of them were, in fact, just sort of sitting there. So the one thing, conclusion we can draw, obviously it's a relatively limited data set, only about a decade of data, but the one conclusion that you can draw from this is that these tree communities, which have been very stable in the tropics for quite a long time, and we know this from the pollen record, and I'm sure there are many people here working on pollen records here in the mid-Atlantic. So these tree communities that have been very stable are starting to break down and change, and new communities are forming. And then you have to ask, you know, what's going to happen to the other creatures that are part of this community, to the, you know, the birds and the mammals and the insects. And that, you know, when you think about it, is obviously much harder to study, because an insect, you know, isn't going to sit there and let you nail a tag into its head. And it isn't going to live very long. It's not going to be there when you come back next year. So these are questions that scientists, you know, are actively working on as I speak. How can we measure this sort of thing? And many, many people are working on it. But as Miles Silman observed to me when we were down in Peru, unfortunately, we are going to find out the answers to these questions, whether we want to or not, because we have set this experiment in motion, and it is now going. We have no control over it. We have no control set up, but we have set the experiment in motion. So how else are we changing the planet? Well, global warming, as you probably know, is not the only effect of pouring billions of tons of carbon into the air every year. There's also what's often called global warming's equally evil twin, and that's ocean acidification. And ocean acidification is happening because when you put a lot of CO2 into the air, a lot of it ends up very, very quickly dissolved in the oceans, in the surface waters of the oceans. And I'm not going to sort of go into the details of ocean acidification. It's a little bit complicated, not terribly complicated. I'm sure many of you are studying it, in fact, in chemistry classes. But basically, all you need to know is this, which is that when you dissolve CO2 in water, you get an acid. If you had Coke today, you drank it, carbonic acid. It's a very weak acid. It's what sort of gives soda its zip. It's why we don't like to drink flat soda, why it tastes too sweet to us. But it is nevertheless an acid, and if you add enough of it to solution, you're going to change its chemistry, even if that solution is as vast as the ocean. So here are just the sort of highlights of ocean acidification. The oceans have absorbed about a third of the CO2 we've put up there since the start of the Industrial Revolution. This is about 150 billion metric tons. Every 4 hours, the seas absorb another million tons of CO2. And the net result is that the acidity of the ocean has already increased by about 30%. So, you know, we don't live in the oceans, obviously, and we don't have a very intuitive sense of what it means to change the chemistry of the water. But if you do live in the oceans, obviously your only interaction with the outside world is through the water, the membrane that separates you from the water. And so the potential effects of changing the chemistry of the oceans are almost infinite. I mean, they can affect every biological process out there. And there are lots and lots of people, and I'm sure there are lots of people here at Rutgers who are studying that, trying to figure out what the impacts of ocean acidification are going to be. But one thing that's already pretty clear is that ocean acidification is making it more difficult. It just makes life more difficult for you. If you are a creature who needs to build a shell or an external skeleton out of the mineral calcium carbonate, just because of the way the chemistry is changing, it becomes harder for you to, in effect, assemble that calcium carbonate. And there turn out to be an awful lot of marine organisms who need to do this. It's estimated, in fact, calcification, this process called calcification, has evolved separately many, many times in the geological record, something like 24 different times. So many organisms that are only very, very distantly related still all calcify in more or less the same way. So just to give you a very quick sample of calcifying organisms in the ocean, these are little tiny creatures called coccolithophores. They're microscopic. You're seeing them here under magnification. They're quite beautiful, as you see. And if you go to a place like the White Cliffs of Dover in England, most of those White Cliffs are made up of the remains of coccolithophores. And if you've ever seen a photo of these sort of milky waters, like big sections of the ocean turn a sort of milky color, that's because there's been a bloom of coccolithophores. And they're really at the very bottom of the marine food chain. Higher up the food chain are animals that we like to eat. Mussels, clams are all calcifiers. Their shells are calcium carbonate. Sea urchins are calcifiers. Those spines of theirs and the shell or test that contains their bodies, that's all calcium carbonate. Starfish, this is a really beautiful kind of vivid blue starfish you see in the Great Barrier Reef. And reefs themselves, coral reefs. So coral, all that a coral reef is this calcium carbonate that's been pumped out by billions and billions of tiny little animals that are corals. So just to give you a sense of what an acidified ocean looks like, I'm going to show you some shots of a really interesting natural experiment that I visited a couple years ago with a British scientist named Jason Hall Spencer. And I was lucky enough to visit this place with a photographer from National Geographic who took these great underwater photos that I'm going to show you. So in this photo, we are underwater. It was very, very cold. We had to go in winter when the water's clear. And we are in the Bay of Naples, off the island of Ischia, off of Italy. And what's interesting about this part of the world, the reason it's a natural experiment is it's a volcanic area. We're not too far from Mount Vesuvius here. And there's actually carbon dioxide just pouring up out of these vents in the ocean floor, just naturally. And so it's sort of a reverse of what we're doing spatially. We are sort of dumping carbon dioxide into the water from above. Here, the CO2 is pouring out of the earth from below, but the effect is the same. You get acidified water. So here we're pretty far from these vents. We have a pH of 8.1. For you chemistry students, pretty alkaline. The oceans should be pretty alkaline. And you see a kind of colorful assembly of Mediterranean creatures, most of which I'm going to confess I can't identify for you. But you see a sea urchin in the foreground there. There's some corals there. And there are also all sorts of these colorful seaweeds, which are calcifying themselves. You get calcifying seaweeds in the ocean. So now imagine we're swimming towards the vent. The pH of the water is going down. The acidity is going up. And this is what it looks like. So we're closer to the vents. You're seeing the CO2 pour out. And you see that most of the life has dropped away. It's a pretty bleak landscape. And what's very sobering to realize here, as you can see, and I don't know if people can read that box, which appeared in National Geographic, but if we sort of keep on our merry way pouring CO2 into the atmosphere and just letting the oceans absorb it, then by the end of this century, all of the oceans will have a pH of 7.8 or below, and potentially all of our oceans will look like that. So another spot that I visited with folks who are studying ocean acidification is this tiny little island on the Great Barrier Reef called One Tree Island. It's a bit of a misnomer because you can see it had more than one tree, but it's just a tiny, tiny little place sticking up out of the Great Barrier Reef. And Darwin, who visited a reef in the South Pacific, not the Great Barrier Reef, but the reef around the island of Morea, during the voyage of the Beagle, wrote that reefs rank amongst the wonderful objects in the world. And any of you who's ever been to a reef, an intact reef, or even a somewhat intact reef, knows that he was right. They really are just amazing places. Something like 25% of all marine species spend at least part of their lives on reefs. And the result of experiments looking at the effects of acidification on reefs, like the one that I visited here on One Tree, and there are a lot of people who are also looking at the effects of warming and ocean acidification on reefs, because as far as corals are concerned, both of those things are bad, so it's sort of a double whammy there. The results of these experiments are pretty sobering. They suggest that reefs may not survive this century. And the importance of that is pretty hard to overstate because, as I said, something like 25% of all marine species spend at least part of their life cycle on a reef. And there have been times in the past when reefs have gone out. They're called reef gaps. And if you go back to those previous mass extinctions that I showed you that graph of, those times are associated with some of the very worst crises in the history of life. So this is just a quote I pulled from a coral biology book. It's not a radical thought at all, unfortunately, now. It's a pretty mainstream thought. It's likely that reefs will be the first major ecosystem in the modern era to become ecologically extinct. So another way that we're changing the planet, and this is the last one I'm going to talk about tonight, though unfortunately I could go on, is simply by moving species around the world. Everyone here is familiar with invasive species. I know there are many people on campus working on this issue. I was just recently in New Zealand, where this is a huge, huge issue. New Zealand is sort of an extreme case because before humans arrived in New Zealand, there were no mammals, no terrestrial mammals. There were a couple of species of bats, but that was it. So they didn't have any, you know, thing like a mouse. They didn't have anything like a deer or you know, a rabbit or a raccoon, any of the groups of mammals that we have here in North America. And humans changed all this. This fellow was the first arrival. He is a Pacific rat. He's kind of cute, as rats go. And he was brought to New Zealand by the Maori around the year 1300. And probably these rats were brought as a food source. The Maori intended to eat the rats, but the rats had other plans for themselves. And they multiplied and they spread a lot faster than they could be consumed. And along the way, they encountered this incredible avian fauna that had evolved in the absence of mammals. And many of these birds were flightless. So there were flightless rails, there were flightless ducks, flightless geese. And since they had evolved in the absence of mammals, they had no defenses against a predator like a rat. And they were very quickly wiped out. And then when the Europeans came along, Captain Cook, back in the 1770s, they immediately brought more rats. They brought ship rats and Norway rats, which are even more voracious predators. And these were accidental introductions. But then purposefully, the British, when they settled, you know, when they came to New Zealand to settle, to live there, they decided that they wanted to have bunnies. Because they wanted to go rabbit hunting. You know, like, why shouldn't we be able to go rabbit hunting? The rabbits came, and they multiplied like rabbits, and they completely overran the countryside. And they themselves obviously had no predators. And New Zealanders are farmers, mostly sheep farmers, and the rabbits were eating all the grass. So the sheep were starving, and people were very, very upset. So they did all sorts of amazing things. They, you know, shot, you know, thousands and thousands of rabbits. It didn't make any perceptible difference in the rabbit population. So they got the great idea of bringing over weasels. Yeah, so this is what they would call a stoat. It's a short-tailed weasel. We don't have short-tailed weasels in the U.S. We have long-tailed weasels, but they're closely related. You get the basic idea. So weasels are really good hunters. But as you have probably already guessed, they did not go after the rabbits. They went after the rest of New Zealand's birds. So this set off a wave of extinctions that is still very much ongoing. And one of the interesting things also about New Zealand's birds, in addition to being flightless, many of them are very smelly. You can literally smell them, you know, from quite a distance away. And birds, other birds, predatory birds, hunt mainly by sight. But mammals hunt by smell. So these birds were just no match for mammalian predators. So I'm just going to show you, you know, a couple birds that are now extinct but that survived long enough that we have specimens of them in museums. This is a bird called the hui. It's a really interesting bird, as you can see, because you're seeing a male and female pair there. And the assumption is that they mated, you know, for life. They hung out together. And then they used their different shaped beaks to hunt different kind of insects. And they survived till around the turn of the 20th century. This is a bird called the Stevens Island Wren. It's another really interesting bird. It was one of the very few flightless songbirds that we know of ever to have existed. And it, too, was wiped out around the turn of the 20th century. So moving, you know, species around the world is something we do all the time now. Many of us have, you know, non-native species in our gardens. We have non-native species as pets. It's once again something that we consider incredibly ordinary. But when you think about it, in a sort of from a geological perspective, it's something that's really incredibly new. Because without a lot of help, a land species cannot cross an ocean, and a marine species cannot cross a continent. So we are bringing together these lineages that evolve separately, in many cases, for tens of millions of years. And when you do that, unfortunately, you can get some pretty nasty surprises. And we have a very good example of that right now in the northeastern US. These are bats, little brown bats. They're the most common bat we have here in the Northeast, and they have white nose syndrome. I'm sure most of you have heard of white nose. That's what you're seeing, that white powdery substance, which someone joked to me makes it look like they were all snorting cocaine. But this fungus, it's a fungus, fungal disease. It doesn't just, you know, affect their noses, it affects their wings, it gets into their wings, and it eats away at the skin on their wings. And in the up here in the Northeast, where when it gets cold in the winter, we have bats that go into hibernation. And they are really, they're what's called true hibernators. They really, really hibernate. Their immune systems shut down. Their body temperature drops. Their heart rate drops. They're in something very, very close to suspended animation. And they have just enough fat reserves to get through the winter if they're lucky. And what happens with white nose, it seems, is that this fungus irritates them. They wake up during the winter. This affects them during the winter. They fly around. There's no food for them. They should be in this state of torpor. And instead of, you know, surviving and finding food, they just end up dropping dead. So here, this disease, we have a very good, we watched it spread in real time. It happened to have landed here in the US, right near where I live, up in upstate New York. I live in Western Mass. It seems to have entered the US somewhere near Albany, New York. That's the first place it was detected. And genetic testing has traced it back to Europe. It was probably brought here completely unwittingly by some visitor, by some tourist. And it's now in 28 states. It's definitely here in New Jersey. It was here pretty early on, and in 5 Canadian provinces. And it recently jumped, and it's been detected in Washington State, so it's now on the West Coast, too. So this is a picture of me and a guy named Scott Darling from the Vermont Fish and Wildlife Department. And this is a few years ago, right after White Nose arrived and emerged and started to do its work. And we're in a cave in Vermont called Aeolus Cave that was the largest bat hibernating place in the Northeast. Something like 300,000 bats would arrive there in this cave, hang upside down, and spend the winter there in this state of suspended animation. And since White Nose arrived around 2008, the number of bats in this cave has dropped by about 90%. And you cannot see it in this picture because the lighting in a cave isn't very good, but we are standing basically on a carpet of a couple of inches of dead bats just carpeting the floor of this cave. And this bringing together of species from different continents is another way you could argue that we are running geological history backward and at a very high speed. So around 250 million years ago, all the world's land masses were squished together in one giant supercontinent, Pangaea. And then the world broke up owing to plate tectonics, and the globe as we know it came into being. And so by bringing these species together that have evolved separately, we are, in effect, you could say, reassembling this supercontinent. And you'll sometimes hear biologists say that we're creating the new Pangaea. So this is now sort of the point in my talk where, you know, if I were following the usual rules of such things, I've, you know, painted this sort of dire picture of all these problems, and I would turn around and tell you what we can and should do about all this. But I do not have that kind of ending. I don't end my book that way, and I'm not going to end tonight that way either. Instead, I'm going to kind of end where I began with another charismatic but sexually confused bird. So this bird is named Sirocco, and I met him when I was in New Zealand. He's a bird called a kakapo, and kakapo are another example of a really interesting bird that exists only in New Zealand. He is the world's only flightless parrot, not he, his species is the world's only flightless parrot. And kakapo are pretty big, they're about osprey-sized, and they're very beautiful, but at the same time, as you can see, they're a little bit comical looking. And they used to be everywhere in New Zealand, in the North Island, in the South Island, and now there are exactly 126 left. And all of them, except for Sirocco himself, live on these two little remote islands that have been very, very laboriously cleared of all of these mammals, introduced mammals, rats, stoats, that sort of thing. And when Sirocco was a chick, he got sick, he got a respiratory infection, so a lot like Kanoe, he ended up being raised by people. And he, too, was imprinted by this process. And so when he reached sexual maturity, he kept trying to mate with people. And as I say, kakapo are pretty big. They're also nocturnal. They're also lek breeders, which means they make a lot of noise during breeding season. And so on these little islands where people were trying to help, you know, nurse this species back from the very, very brink, you had, you know, conservation rangers and also a lot of volunteer workers. And during mating season, Sirocco would, you know, get up, someone was getting up, you know, to go pee or something in the middle of the night, and he would fly at them and try to mate with them. So it was decided that for his own sake and the sake of everybody involved, he would have to be moved. And so he now lives basically on his own little private island. But sometimes he goes on tour. That's where I saw him. Because except for Sirocco, New Zealanders will never see a kakapo. And we are seeing him here actually behind a very thick plate of safety glass there. And people had come. I drove to this spot, and New Zealanders had driven for many, many miles and had paid $50 a piece to get a look at Sirocco, because as I say, except for that, no one will ever see them. And so Sirocco, I think, is another emblem of this very strange world that we are creating. And this is not because humans are vicious or indifferent, though they, or we, certainly are capable and have those capacities. But as your president here tonight testifies, we also have many other possible qualities, curiosity, concern, caring, biophilia. Ultimately, I sort of have come to feel that we have a lot in common with Canoe and Sirocco ourselves, in that we are rather confused creatures, too. And I'm going to end it there tonight, and then I'd be happy to take questions if you have it. Thanks very much.
Hello, everyone. My name is Xenia Morin, and I will be moderating this question and answer period. We have a tradition at the School of Environmental and Biological Sciences, and that is to ask that students get the first opportunity to ask questions. And since there are a lot of students here, and I know some of your faculty have put you up to coming here, I am going to say that maybe you could get an extra credit if you asked a question. Now, I can't promise that, but I think it would be nice if your faculty acknowledged that. And for those of you that are outside in the overflow room, if you want to enter the room from the back, you can come in and certainly ask your questions as well. So, where are those students? There are mics on both sides, so if you would kindly line up behind the mic, that would be wonderful. So we have our first brave student. Thank you for coming up. If you could give your name and ask your question, please. You may need to tip that down.
Yeah, I'm a little bit short.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, my name is Cezanne Bees. I am a freshman in Extinction, but I was wondering a fairly simple question. What was the most interesting place you visited during this experience of just traveling the world?
Well, that's a good question. It's a hard question to answer because a lot of the places were really amazing. I guess I would put the Great Barrier Reef up there as the most amazing place just to see. The incredible, you know, what you can see on a reef, you can never see on land, you know, that much life at one time. Even if you're in a rainforest, you're actually not, you're just seeing trees, you're not seeing many animals. But if you look, you know, down on a reef, you see an amazing collection of animals. It's incredible.
Thank you.
Let's go over here, please.
Hello. My name is Serena Fernandez, and I'm also in Extinction. What did you hope when people read the Sixth Extinction? What did you hope would inspire them? Like, what did you hope for them to get out of it?
Well, that's a very good question. I hoped that people would, you know, it's a pretty, you know, basic aspiration of journalists that you are trying to draw attention to something. And I was trying to draw attention to what's going on, to the scope and the scale of how we are changing the world and how, what the, you know, possible ramifications of that are. I do not have my own, you know, 10-point plan for how to solve this. These really, really, really monumental issues. But I guess it seemed to me that, you know, unless people, you know, appreciate the scale of the issues, you know, we can't really take any kind of effective steps. So it was simply, my hope is simply, you know, and it sounds kind of lame when I say it, but it was to raise awareness.
Thank you.
Let's go over here, please.
Hello. My name is Lyra Brindisi, and I'm a senior majoring in biology. And I'm curious as to what kind of future you envision for my generation.
that's a good one. That's That is a very good question. You know, I have kids very your age. I have three children, you know, one of whom just graduated college, and two of whom are twins who are hoping to go to college. And I think about that a lot. And I think that you are going to be dealing with some very difficult issues. I'm not going to kid you. I think that the world is, you know, becoming a more crowded and less, you know, less predictable place. How's that? And that my generation has not done a good job of leaving you with a better world. I think we have to be frank about that. That being said, I really don't know what the future holds for you guys, and you know, what people are going to figure out, you know, what either good things or horrible things people are going to figure out to do over the next half century or so, depending on how long you're planning to be around. So I'm going to leave that as a big question mark. As I say, it's something that definitely keeps me up at night, though.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Elizabeth Nand, and I'm a junior genetics major. I was just wondering if you get angry when there's a whole cohort of people trying to undermine the science that's so very clear, and if you do, then how do you handle it?
Well, that's a great question. I am not a person who gets angry or get depressed, and I think it's very depressing, and this political campaign has been super, super depressing on so many levels. But that's one of it. Just, you know, that we could be having such the level of there's no level. It's not, to call it discourse is to elevate it. It has, you know, and I think that given, you know, the scale of the problems and the scale of the effort that's needed to address them, you know, we were sort of taking some baby steps forward, and I fear that we are taking big steps backwards, but we're gonna find out. We're gonna see what happens on Election Day and after Election Day. So I think it's really, it's frightening. It's frightening, and you know, I'm sure there are many climate scientists here who can speak to it better than I can, but the kind of harassment, you know, that people are subject to, you know, the kind of, you know, legal, you know, people be having all their emails subpoenaed, blah blah blah, who are doing the most, you know, just basic science. It is a pretty frightening statement about where we've come.
I'm going to make sure everyone gets to ask. So if I could have two of you ask questions and then have you try and answer both, you know, and then we'll go to two, just so that we can
we'll
get
try
through.
It.
But if it's not working, let me know.
Okay,
so
okay.
If you could introduce yourself, please.
Hello, ma'am. My name is Stephen Adeni. My question is sort of like a two-parter. Over the course of your career...
Oh, no, the system is falling apart. Okay, go ahead.
Over the course of your career in this science, what would you say is the most difficult part of your experiment and your research, and what do you wish you could have done differently?
Oh, wow, those are good questions. Okay. Well, the most difficult part, I mean, that's sort of a complicated question because there are things that are difficult to understand, you know, just as a non-scientist, and then there are things that are difficult to write because of narrative, the demands of narrative, and they're not necessarily the same thing. So I'm gonna punt on that a little bit. And what do I wish I'd done differently? Wow, that's a good question. I'm a little too, yeah, I got to think about that. I'm going to circle back to that. How's that? There's so many things I wish I'd done differently in my life, but you don't want to hear about those. So, yeah. I'm going to, let me think. If I think of something that can be said in mixed company, I will.
All right, thank you so much.
Go to the next person here, please.
Hi, my name is Alex Nafeld, and I'm an environmental policy major. I was just wondering, you talk a lot about, you know, this regression in terms of geological era. So you kind of, we're seeing a resurgence in carbon emissions that, in carbon levels rather, that weren't present before, you know, several epochs back. What kind of concrete theories already exist in terms of what kind of impacts this will have on the global ecosystem, like maybe potentially, you know, incurring potential cataclysmic events, if you know of any?
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, one of the great questions, and that's, you know, it's a very good question, and so, you know, everything that exists on Earth has ancestors, you know, that in effect, you know, have lived through many, many different, you know, times, and, you know, that were around in the Eocene and even before the last major extinction, because we're all, you know, descendants of survivors of that extinction. And the question is whether organisms retain the adaptations they had to a much warmer world 20, 30, 40, 50 million years ago. And we just don't know the answer to that, right? So that is one question, you know, that we're, you know, going to find out, unfortunately. Now, when you look in the oceans, too, you know, that there things become, in a sense, even more frightening because it's not clear that creatures have any experience with, you know, even going way, way back with what we're doing to the oceans. So I think that marine scientists are really worried. You hear this phrase, the rise of slime. You know, are we going to get this ocean that's filled with, you know, creatures that are really, really ancient, you know, and fascinating and interesting, jellyfish and things like that, but where, you know, we're so busy overfishing and changing the chemistry of the oceans. Are we going to get these sort of empty oceans?
Thank you.
So two questions, if we can.
Okay. Hi, my name is Rishi. I'm a sociology major, and I was wondering, from a writing perspective, what do you think is the most effective way to convince people of climate change or anything in general?
Okay, we're going to take that. We're going to take another question, too, and I'm going to try to answer them, going to cross them and answer them both. How's that? Yeah.
Okay. Hello, Ms. Kolbert. My name is Jacob. I am a junior and an English major, and I was not forced to come here.
You get extra credit, yeah.
Thank you. Do you feel the viewpoint, in terms of science, the viewpoint that climate change is not real is objectively wrong? Do you feel like the media is too accommodating to people, politicians, for example, who propagate that viewpoint? Like, would you like to see journalists be more assertive when talking to people who deny climate change?
Okay, so let me take the first question. They're both good questions. The first question is, I can very honestly say I don't know. You know, people have tried all sorts of different tactics. You know, I've tried my tactic, many other, you know, people have tried, you know, movies and films and polemics and, you know, you name it, everything's been tried. Has it done any good? You know, I like to think it's done a little good, but obviously we're still in the mess that we're in, which brings us to question number two. I think that, you know, I think that definitely the, you know, denier camp or whatever you want to call them got off way too easy for a long time. I think that journalists are getting better at, you know, calling them out. But the profound problem that we have is that, you know, politicians do, you know, there's a, you know, it's a dialectic. I don't want to say that politicians control the discourse, but even you can see in this campaign by not talking about it, you know, we don't get coverage of it. We get coverage of the things that people talk about. And when you have deniers, and you do have them in Congress in very key positions, like head of the House Science Committee, you know, yeah, I know, take that as an irony. It's really hard. They set a certain agenda, and, you know, I don't want to let journalists off easy, but we also need to, you know, vote people out of office. Thank you.